Hi, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us. And welcome to this panel discussion on singing for well-being and being well while singing. My name is Jennifer Coleman-Pears, and I'm Interim Chief Exec of the Voices Foundation, and it's my great pleasure to be hosting the session this afternoon. The Voices Foundation is a charity that works alongside teachers and school communities to embed and transform music education so that children can be supported in developing their wider skills, but also well-being, through accessible singing programmes. We deliver continuing professional development and learning for educators, inspiring content for parents, and deliver really in-depth research and evaluation too. And it's really our belief that by working together, we can ensure that every child can find their voice through the power of singing. So really excited about the topic that we've got today. So thank you so much to our four panellists for joining. So as I was saying, really, four really fantastic panellists, all bringing very different kind of backgrounds and experience. So hopefully we should have an interesting discussion for everybody listening in today. And I really wanted to start with, I guess, a slightly kind of provocative question, which I hope that everyone, not just on the panel, but everyone attending the session today would feel like they had an answer to. But just to really kind of kick us off, why sing? What's the point in singing? Why are we having this conversation? Why sing? And maybe Deborah, I could kick back to you to start with.
Well, I think we've been singing for a very long time, probably since ancient man started doing cave paintings. So for thousands and thousands of years, humankind has been gathering together to use their voices to sing. And I think we're just about the only animal that really does that in any meaningful or combined sense. And we find singing all the way through every single part of our culture. No matter which culture you're looking at, you will find singing. You'll also find dancing, painting, drawing, etc. It is part of the fundamental expressive arts that make us a human being. Obviously, you will find it all the way through various religious followings. You'll see it all the way through the great choral tradition that we've got in this country, which at the moment is tremendously under threat as a result of COVID-19, with many choirs disappearing in our churches. So it has a long and illustrious history. And that comes all the way through to the classroom and the importance for well-being, for singing. It makes you feel good when you sing, but it also has lots of extrinsic properties in terms of developing sociability, improving things like coordination, memory, etc. So there's all kinds of extrinsic as well as intrinsic benefits to singing.
Amazing, thank you. Claire, do you maybe bring the kind of educator's perspective on this? Why sing? Why do you have singing as a priority for your school?
That's fine. Well, we've seen a lot of the time at Eastfield, it really has brought the community together. So in terms of our school improvement journey recently here and also at a previous school I've worked at, it's really brought us all together, that kind of, even from the staff training, it's brought us together as a staff team. We've, you know, we're really lucky with our trainers, and we have a bit of a giggle, and, you know, and inhibitions are lost in the end. And we see the same in the classroom as well. It really brings everyone together. We have a really high proportion of EAL learners at Eastfield, just over 50%. And it's really inclusive. They can all join in. They're learning new songs together. We've got lots of opportunities for their kind of building their self-esteem in terms of we have a choir, and the expectations and the standard of the choir has really improved. And not just the choir, different year groups as well have been at the theatre and sung. We're lucky enough to have an opera house because of David Ross, where they've been and sung. So lots of different things. But their well-being, if their self-esteem and their well-being, then we know that impacts really positively on their academic learning. It really helps with their engagement. And we've definitely seen the impact, the positive impact of that here.
Martin, you've spent your kind of life in and around choirs and music. What's your take? Why sing? Why bother?
Why? Well, because William Byrd, one of our greatest ever composers, said singing is so good a thing. And he was right. I know he was right because I sing. So is this just my opinion? No. I've done lots of research with children and they tell me that William Byrd was right. They tell me that singing is a very good thing. They know because they do it. There are more technical reasons. It's the best way known to man of promoting audiation, that is, the internalization of musical concepts and thinking musically. You do that by singing. Voices are free. I wanted to play the bassoon and never could because I couldn't afford one, but I can sing for nothing. Every child has a free musical instrument. It lifts the spirits quite uniquely. There is nothing like singing that raises the joy of man and woman and the dog and the cat, and it's wonderful. And right now, I can tell you, because I teach singing to children, they missing it, they need it. That's why.
Thank you, Martin. I think Jennifer has just dipped out again. It looks like we're going to have a fun game to play. John, what are your thoughts on the value of singing coming from your experience working with young people?
Well, I've tried to sing, and I'm afraid I don't have a very good voice, but I can make a noise, as a lot of children can. Singing is a form of communication, and from a safeguarding position, what we do know is that if you can give children the confidence to be able to speak out, then they are least at risk. Children who are abused are often, almost certainly, groomed to try to remain silent. And I think that the previous contributors raised a couple of themes for me. One was around improving sociability, the other one, self-esteem and confidence. Any activity that can enhance self-esteem, confidence and sociability enables children to be better protected. So I think singing, particularly if you're going to do it in front of a very large audience, requires a huge amount of confidence. You're actually giving a very clear message, particularly that adults are listening to you. Children are extremely worried, particularly victims of abuse, that adults won't take any notice of them. And as I said, they do find it extremely difficult to speak out. So any mechanism in place that enables children to have the confidence to say something, particularly to individuals that they may not have familiarity with, like a live audience, for instance, I think enables them to have the confidence to speak out when they're victims of abuse as well. So to me, there's a clear advantage here in serving children to make sure that they have the confidence to come forward when they are victims of abuse, or indeed when they have any other concerns about their welfare. So it's a good start. As another contributor said, educationally, I think, like other musical activities, it aids to the academic progress on other subject areas as well. So let's keep it up. And I'd be interested to see the research around, Martin, whether there is any, around children who are at risk or who may be at risk, and the action that they take when they have concerns about their welfare, in cohorts who are actively participating in singing and those that don't. I think there'd probably be a surprising correlation there at some point.
Clearly I'm going to be popping in and out of this discussion, but it just keeps things interesting. I think to your point, John, I think that's definitely something that the Voices Foundation, that we found that there's something kind of directly linked between you engaging in singing and confidence in speaking out. So particularly, I mean, Claire mentioned it, that at their school they have a significant number of pupils that have English as an additional language, and you know, we've heard that from many of our kind of teachers across the country, that actually, you know, children with English as a second language who maybe wouldn't normally put themselves forward or feel confident to raise their hand, and once they've been engaged in singing, actually do find that they have the confidence to speak out in front of others. And you know, I don't know if there's any specific research around that kind of link then to kind of vulnerable children coming forwards, but it seems that there's a sort of something that we could intuit there in terms of the connection between the confidence that children have to, you know, to be able to perform and to project their voices, and as you say, to then you know, to speak up when they need to.
I think it helps that we start so early on, because obviously we've got a nursery, so our voices starts from nursery throughout, so you know, they're learning those communication language skills right from the beginning, and it really promotes that for us and then follows through with them. So by the time, I'm really excited to see it move through the school, because they do just gain in confidence, and it's part of our everyday.
And it is, believed that singing is a discrete intelligence. and all of the different intelligences are linked. And if you miss one of them out, that does have an impact across all ways of being intelligent. And that is true. But I always come back to what I said first. I had a colleague once who said, we don't teach Mozart to stop shoplifting. We teach Mozart because he's bloody good. And we must not forget that music is damn good. And singing is one of the best forms of music. It has intrinsic value in itself. And that must not be forgotten.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a very important point. I guess just bringing us back to the kind of the well-being piece, you know, I think we're all kind of in agreement that singing does have a very positive impact on children's well-being as well as their skill development. As you say, it's kind of very much kind of the two are interconnected. But I guess again, a slightly kind of provocative question: why is that something that we should care about right now? I mean, there's been a lot of publication around the increase in attainment gap. So Education Endowment Fund saying that the last 10 years worth of progress that's been made in closing that attainment gap between the richest and poorest students has essentially been wiped out in the 3 months sort of during the pandemic, and both in sort of direct and indirect consequences of it. So again, just being slightly kind of profited, isn't that where we should be focused? Should we not be focused on attainment? Isn't the kind of push to focus on numeracy and literacy, isn't that where we should be? Why should we care about this kind of well-being piece or the kind of intrinsic benefit of music piece?
Can I come in there? Because from my experience of working in a number of nations, also the UK, but there's some common factors about social isolation. And when children are socially isolated, they develop fantasies, they develop beliefs about threats to them. Yes, some of them are real, some of them may not be quite so real, but there's an increase in self-harm. There's a significant worry about their future, etc. I think anything that encourages them not only to sing privately, but to actually get out there, yeah, and participate in some sort of group activity, whether it's online or whether it's face-to-face at a social distance, that must be encouraging. It's about moving children from a state of isolation to being part of a group. So I think things like choirs, for instance, whether it's, as I said, online now or as a collective group, has an added social advantage to overcome some of the social isolation issues that children are facing at the moment. And I'll go back to my original point that where children are socially isolated, they're easier to maintain that level of secrecy when they are victims of abuse. And any contact that enables them to speak out, and indeed any contact that enables them to have further relationships with trusted adults outside the family, so they have an opportunity to talk during rehearsals, etc., about what's happening, can only be beneficial to their welfare. So an activity like this, among other activities, I think help galvanize and give children the opportunity to share their thoughts, worries and concerns, which they're finding increasingly difficult to do other than in their peer group at the moment.
Can I just kind of follow up on this? Because I think we need to remember that singing does take place, well, we want it to take place within a school setting. And of course, we have a pandemic going on at the moment, which means that the DfE has been sending out all kinds of mixed messages around what is the value of what it perceives to be non-core subjects. And about 2 or 3 weeks ago, we had a leak to the TES, which was saying that the government's position was that schools could drop non-core subjects for 2 terms. And that certainly sent shockwaves through the ISM, which is the Subject Association for Music Education, because non-core subjects means things like music. The government then clarified that about 2 days later and said, no, it's not what they meant at all. They didn't mean non-core subjects could be dropped for 2 terms. It was all very important, broad and balanced curriculum, etc. But since then, we have seen heads of some of the academy chains coming out and saying, well, perhaps we don't need to be focusing on all those non-core subjects because of the importance of catch-up. Now, the problem with catch-up, it seems to me, is if you are just asking your children to study maths, English and science endlessly, it may not be a particularly scintillating educational experience for more than about a week. And the children are going to feel pretty alienated from that kind of educational experience. So we need to go back to basics here, which is under the national curriculum, all children should have access to a broad and balanced curriculum. And that does mean music as well. Now we know academies don't have to follow the national curriculum. And so there is an institutional problem that we've got within the current maintained school setup, where academies, particularly are dominant within the secondary school setting, don't have to ensure that children are actually getting the benefit of a broad and balanced curriculum all the way through up to GCSEs. And we know from some of the work that we've been doing in terms of research that music in particular has had a very rough ride at Key Stage 3, disappearing so that the schools can focus on GCSEs a year early. And I guess from the ISM's perspective, we're really, really concerned that COVID-19 is going to give an excuse to government to continue to send out those messages that on the one hand, yes, we really value music, but on the other hand, there is this thing called the catch-up curriculum. So why don't you just perhaps marginalize non-core subjects? So I think we have to be very, very clear in our messaging back to government that music is a core subject, no matter what they may think. Music is a core subject. It's vitally important, as we've heard, both intrinsically and extrinsically. And also, just looking forward, we do have a burgeoning music industry. Well, we did prior to the pandemic, a really strong music industry worth £5.2 billion. It's not to be sniffed at. So music should be one of those subjects that should be cosseted and nurtured in our schools rather than marginalised.
I would totally agree with that. And the point I wanted to make, wearing my purely education professor hat, is children have got a lot of catching up to do with numeracy and literacy. And there's two ways you can do it. You can teach numeracy for an hour, full stop, and have stressed out, fed up children at the end of it. Or you can teach numeracy for 20 minutes, stop, sing for 10 minutes, and then teach another 20 minutes numeracy. And you'll have children who have caught up a lot more on their numeracy by the end of that hour. Somebody's going to tell me that 2 20s and 10 don't make 6. Yes, they do. but no, seriously. It's basic psychology of how children learn and how long a 9-year-old can stare at numbers. Whereas music is this is instrumentalist, but it is a rejuvenating break that will increase the learning of numeracy and literacy and all the other catching up that's got to be done.
One thing I would add, and I'll keep going, focusing on the safeguarding element, you can imagine children returning to school have had a period of isolation. Terrible things could have happened to them. They're coming to school, if they're hot-housed in technical subjects, and I understand why you want to do that, and they don't have the opportunity to relax in school, yeah, and undertake artistic activities and games and things like that, then if they're coming from a harmful background, they're not going to be able to focus on the academic work that schools want them to catch up on. So it's a non-brainer, really. You've got to give children an opportunity to express themselves in a safe setting. Schools are a safe setting. We know that when children undertake art, sometimes they express themselves on paper through painting, etc. And teachers will talk to them as, why did you draw this? What is this saying? And this opens up a conversation. I suspect with music, if children are particularly choosing particular types of music, you may have a conversation with the child, and song, for instance, about, well, why are you choosing that? What does it mean for you? And that in itself can start opening up conversations. So I think the loss of singing, like a loss of other school activities to make sure that children are hot-housed, is counterproductive.
There is no point in children going to school if they don't express themselves, because they've been sitting at home watching BBC things about learning numbers for the last 3 months. They want to make noise with other children. They desperately need to. That's why they go to school.
One of the things we've been talking about is that opportunity to reconnect. Obviously, we've got some children here, but not everybody. And the children that haven't come back to school yet and their families will probably be feeling as anxious as those that, not all, but some will, that came back on the 1st of June. So one of the things we've really been talking about is how we're going to reconnect. We're really lucky, and at both primary and secondary level, music is very important to our trust. We are lucky with the opportunities that we are given. So definitely it's part of our plan, it's part of our timetable in September. There will of course be ad hoc opportunities as well, but it is very much little and often on a daily basis. It's what our children are used to. It's fun, and it is going to be a way, not for everybody, for the majority will access, and it will really help us reconnect once we get back for the other things such as English and maths and everything else to fall back into place as well.
Little and often, absolutely right. I totally agree with you there. I'm glad you do it. Little and often, every day, a bit of music.
Claire, I suspect whilst there are challenges to bring families into school to watch singing events, at some point that is going to happen, I assume. You might even be able to do it now on a limited basis. But in terms of reconnecting, you'll also have an opportunity if you get children singing in choirs, etc., and they want to perform to a wider audience where it's socially possible, you'll be able to reconnect to parents as well. And there'll be a lot of parents out there who've had experiences that have impacted on their children and would want to have an opportunity. And no doubt you have had an experience of parents coming to you about the worries that they've had with their families and their children. And that helps to connect the schools up to adults as well, and to parents particularly, if you are able to manage these kind of larger events where children are, you know, their singing skills are utilised in terms of getting parents together and watching those in those events.
Yeah, definitely. I think one of the worst bits of the current situation is obviously our first year of Voices should have culminated in a big celebration and lots of singing, which unfortunately we haven't been able to do, but we have been talking about how moving forward we are going to be doing more of that. I think the posts that have been sent out from my music lead with her singing songs and different things, the Voices Foundation assemblies, I had a parent contact me the other day annoyed because she couldn't find them. I think some of our most positive feedback has been around the music, parents commenting how much they enjoyed hearing the teacher sing, and then the children were singing at home as well. We've had lots of positive feedback. So there are definitely things that we need to think about moving forward. And how, as we were saying before, you know, technology now, we've all got a lot better with technology, or we certainly have in our school. So it's now how we kind of use that to our advantage.
And one of the key questions that obviously, you know, people in your position, Claire, will have to be weighing up with the kind of risks, and I'm sure a lot of people who've kind of, you know, dialed in to join us today, that's one of the kind of key questions I imagine that's kind of at the top of mind, is what do we actually know about the risks? There's been a lot that's been kind of talked about in terms of the kind of the dangers of singing, or the risks involved with singing. Martin, maybe you could sort of share a little bit about what we actually know and what we don't yet know.
Yes, indeed. The answer is we actually don't know that much. We know in reality a lot less than all of the chatter you get on social media and this, that and the other. Any good quality peer-reviewed scientific paper is going to say we don't know enough. Now I'd probably, because you know we don't have all night, I'd concentrate on two of the most relevant features to where we are today. The first is this wretched business of airborne infection. Now this is pretty important. It is the threat of airborne infection that has silenced choirs around the world. And where we are with this at the moment is that for the last 2 months, the World Health Organization has been downplaying it and saying it doesn't matter. And, you know, the virus is transmitted by close personal contact, by not washing your hands and then touching your face, by droplets when you cough that fall on surfaces that you touch. That has been the dominant World Health Organization view, and that obviously informs all the stress that we've had on social distancing and hygiene and all of that. Now, that is undoubtedly important, but many of you will have heard of these famously reported cases of choirs in Washington State and in Amsterdam are the two most celebrated cases. There was another one in Germany where there was a very inexplicably high infection rate of the singers in the choirs attending rehearsals. Now, the reality is that there's been a great media panic about that, and it has given choral singing a bad name. But the WHO, they're not bothered. They have not funded big research studies on this. They are worried. If you read what they're saying, all of their outputs, they're all about infection rates in hospital waiting rooms and how risky is it to a medical professional performing a close, you know, inserting a tube in somebody's mouth. That's what WHO are talking about. So the amount of research that has been done on this business that loud vocalization nebulizes the breath. I mean, this is the technical bit. nebulizing, as I'm sure you know, is when you break fluids up into tinier and tinier particles. When the vocal folds smash together, as they do in a child's voice hundreds of times every second, the squeezing together of the breath by the vocal folds is smashing that breath up into tiny little particles, which you probably know are called aerosols. These then float around in the room, and as they're floating around in the room in their millions, they evaporate and get smaller, which increases the concentration of the virus. I'm going to come to some good news in a minute, so hang on in there. The biggest threat of all, by the best science that we currently have, is that if you socially distance your singers, if you clean every surface, if you have no sharing of the music, if you have one-way systems, everybody washes their hands, everybody does everything right, but one person gets a lift to school or choir with somebody who has got the virus and doesn't even know it, that one person going into an enclosed space where there is singing will infect everybody in spite of all the hand washing and social distancing. Now, that's stating it at its worst. There are many, many risk mitigation factors like decreasing the number of people, doing it in the largest possible space, opening the windows. But the other big elephant in the room is children. Now, the thing with children is that they are the lowest risk group by a very significant factor. I mean, it's several orders of magnitude. The risk to grandma compared to the risk of an 8-year-old, it's incomparably different. So we have to say that if we are working with children, we are working in a lower risk situation. I think that is undoubtedly the case. But has expensive research been done on whether an untrained child singer produces less aerosol than an opera singer who's had 10 years of intensive professional training? No, because the reality of it, this research is tremendously expensive, and they're only just persuading people to do research on professional singers. we're not going to get really good quality scientific research on children's voices, not this side of the Christmas that the donkey has kittens. I mean, that's the reality of it. Yeah. And all I would say is that children are low risk. And if you sing for a short period with the windows open, and you've done all the other things, the only comfort I can give you is that I am doing this study. It's called First Choir Standing, and we're looking at choirs that have resumed around the world and all of the risks and precautions they've taken. Many of those choirs have been children's choirs. None of them, the children have got ill. And the most interesting case of all is the Stockholm Boys Choir, because Sweden, as you know, adopted a very liberal approach and they didn't lock down. And that seems to validate what I've just said, because the very high infection rate they had in Sweden was all with their elderly population. The Stockholm Boys Choir did not stop rehearsing. They gave a concert recently which was streamed. There was no live audience, but none of those boys or their families reported sickness. Now, I will be told off by the medical professionals for saying that. Oh, you can't say that just because no boy in the choir died, it's safe. But it is nevertheless the case that children are low risk, and none of those boys got ill. And that's where I would start with this.
So I guess there's clearly a lot that we don't know from a kind of scientific perspective. There's maybe a lot that's been blown out of proportion or kind of extrapolated that, you know, we're kind of saying actually no, there science isn't there. So given, you know, the you know, people that are listening in today are kind of thinking, well, okay, in that case, how do I sort of plan for this? Obviously there is guidance in place. So Deborah, maybe you could just say before we kind of turn to the participant questions, just a few words on what guidance there is currently and where people should be looking, because there has been, I think, some confusion recently about the guidance that came out from DCMS in relation to kind of to choirs, and then the advice that's come out from DfE. So maybe you could just say a little bit on that and then we'll come to the Q&A.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think the DCMS guidance reads across into an educational setting, and that's where I would start. And from the conversation I had with the DfE on Friday, they are still working on their guidance. So I don't think we can say that what they've come out with so far is definitive. And we're obviously not scientists at the ISM. ISM is just made up of thousands and thousands of musicians. But we commissioned two students, one's a postdoc and one's actually studying for her doctorate, to undertake a global literature review, because we were getting so concerned at the different mixed messages coming out from DfE, where it's very difficult to understand what we're being told to do, and from DCMS, which was very confused because they also had the brass and the woodwind issues going on. And there kept being these very strange missives coming out of Public Health England, where all the brass players suddenly thought, well, that's the end of my career forever. So we thought, well, we'll go off and do a global literature review and see what everybody else is saying. So ISM tomorrow is going to publish this document. It's about 30 pages long, and we're absolutely not giving guidance. It's absolutely not what the document is going to do. But what it does do, it just collates together everything that we have found. And there is lots of guidance out there in places in particular like Canada around music education in schools and how to do it safely. And we're not saying that you shouldn't be following DfE guidance, etc. We just think it's useful to know that there are lots of other countries out there that have been working in this field. And I'm a great believer if you can't have too much information, let's just pull it all together and see what it looks like. And that will hopefully help the conversation going forward. One last thing, I was having a conversation with a specialist in throats at the weekend, and he has been commissioned by the DCMS to work on a piece of research linked to singing brass and woodwind, but that's in the performance space. And I did say to him, well, how is that going to read across into the education space? And he said, well, that's a whole different area. So I think we have to be very careful not to read across whatever DCMS is coming up with, which is very specific to enclosed and often very difficult buildings, like if you think about a Victorian theatre, which doesn't have a lot of ventilation. You know, you can't just throw open the doors and there'll be a nice draft coming through. Victorian theatres are very difficult spaces in terms of ventilation. DCMS has been working for weeks in terms of its guidance and is now seeking further evidential support. So I don't think you can read across from DCMS into the education space, but I do think we need to be talking as a sector to DfE so we find something which is proportionate and doesn't lead to the demise of music education in our schools, which is what I personally fear.
Thank you, Deborah. Great, well, let's turn to the question. I've got about 15 minutes left, so I want to make sure we pick up some of our attendee questions. And I guess there are a couple that sort of relate to that sort of theme that we've just been talking about. So one from Sally Ismay asking, will whole class singing be safe in September? What do the panel recommend? So I guess currently the DfE guidance is in groups no larger than 15. But I guess what you're saying, Deborah, is that we're not quite sure where the guidance will end up. So come September, it could say something different.
Absolutely. So I think as with much of this area, what is happening today is not the position next week. Mm-hmm. Certainly at the ISM, you know, we have noticed new stuff coming out from all the government departments we talk to on an almost daily basis. So we are continually having to update members on what is best practice in all these different settings. So nothing is set in stone. And going back to what Martin was saying, there's an absolute absence of evidential base here. What we've got is assumptions and anecdotes and clusters, but we don't actually have scientific evidence. And until we get some proper scientific evidence, I think it's going to be very difficult to come up with meaningful guidance.
Mm-hmm. And nobody is going, you know, as Deborah says, nobody is going to say we, the ISM, or we, ABCD, or whoever we are, we're not going to say it's safe. We can't. What we say at ABCD is these are the risks as we best know them, and you have to do what your government or LEA or whatever says. And the other problem with questions about September, all of this goes up and down with the infection rate in the general population. Now, at the moment, it's probably the lowest it's going to be because we're just coming out of lockdown, which undoubtedly, there's very little doubt that if you lock down early, you reduce the infection rate in the general population. But there is a relationship with the climate and the hours of sunlight and the humidity. So we don't know where we will be in September. And I wish I could give you a more certain answer than that.
So I guess the kind of advice really is to keep an eye as the guidance is coming through. And I guess, you know, from the Voices Foundation perspective, and Claire, it'd be interesting to get your kind of perspective on this. The key thing is to make sure that music is incorporated into that curriculum, exactly what the kind of parameters are in terms of what you can deliver might change. So at the moment, it might be planning on singing in groups of 15, or Sheila Seal has commented that she wonders if singing can be a replacement. So certainly things like singing, body percussion, there are other elements of kind of singing and musicianship that can come through rather than just the kind of choral. But that, you know, if you kind of, at least if you've made time for it, you've prioritised it within the curriculum space, that come September, should the guidance have changed, then, you know, hopefully we can kind of do more than we think, or at least do things differently. So I guess, Claire, would that be your perspective, that it's important to just make sure that it's sort of still there at the heart of your curriculum, and then you'll just keep an eye on the guidance as it changes?
Yeah, and get used to doing the risk assessments. I mean, we've been doing a lot of work around the risk assessments and putting them out to the membership, etc. So, you know, people will be used to doing risk assessments, particularly around, say, safeguarding. So this is another risk assessment, but just in a different space. So, you know, almost use this as your practice run for September.
Yeah, I would absolutely go with that. And the other thing is, what is the status of school children? Now, that's an interesting question, because if you look at the DCMS guidance, and this has caused a lot of upset in the choral community, but it is small groups of professional singers for work purposes who can come back first. Now, there are very good reasons for that. Small groups of professional singers are easy to control. They the same people each day, and they probably have their own dedicated space. They've got their own rehearsal room in the university or wherever they work. The opposite extreme to that is the amateur community choir of 100 plus people that rents the village hall and shares it with the gym club and the slimming club and the ladies' doodah and everything. And they are the people who are really, really clobbered. And when you look at DCMS and DFE, in my area of work, where we have quite a lot to do with cathedral choirs, the boys and girls who sing in a cathedral choir are both the property of DCMS and DFE, because when they're in school, they're children at school. When they're at choir, they're quasi professional singers. And when I put that question at the DCMS round table, the answer I got was, well, when they're in choir, they're the DCMS problem. And when they're at school, they're the DFE problem. So there's an interesting bit of context there.
Yeah. And I do think that reads across into other areas of music education. So you're absolutely right about that DCMS, DFE line, which is blurry in some places. But then when you start talking about private teachers, the guidance there has been coming out largely from BEIs, which is very odd. So they're kind of treating them like home professionals doing massages, going into clients' houses. It's very curious. And when we spoke to DFE about this, they said, well, it's all about adults. And I had to explain to them that an awful lot of private music classes were actually focused on the under 18s. So again, there is this lack of clarity around the guidance in particular settings, which we desperately need at the moment.
Yeah. Claire, can I put this next question to you, which kind of picks up on what we've just been talking about, which is from Saffron, who says, head teachers are planning around the current guidance and the message that singing should be avoided, and their position is unlikely to change between now and September, as they've got too many things to consider. So as in, head teacher's position is unlikely to change. Obviously, the guidance is likely to change. So the question is it too late to be planning for the autumn term? Could you maybe just say a little bit about how you're approaching that, where the guidance currently sits, but knowing that it's likely to change?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, obviously, we're hopeful that it might change in terms of being able to sing in larger groups, but we've been planning to the guidance as it is now. As you mentioned earlier, we have been thinking about September and how we're going to get around this. As somebody said on the chat, we have been talking a lot, and our music team have been supporting us with thinking about the other things that we can do, such as body percussion, using simple instruments like claves that are really easily cleaned, beakers, you know, chopsticks, whatever, so that we can carry on that small and often, which is always what we do. We will discourage certain kind of warm-ups and different things. Some of the voices warmed up, some of the ones that the children really love, they are quite loud, as you said, and perhaps we would discourage them and be careful in which ones we do pick. We've been quite creative, I'm sure other head teachers are the same. I've got risk assessments and timetables coming out of my ears. So when children have their outside time, the 15 could go out, the 15 in could do some singing and vice versa. We can do singing outside. We're hoping to do lots of listening to music. And again, when we usually have our choral person coming in, so when Charlotte from Voices would come in, that's going to be done via Teams or other online methods. So there are ways around it. And as I've already mentioned, and you said, John, as well, about that connection with home, we're going to be able to record songs, ask them to practice them at home, and that type of thing as well.
I'm glad Claire mentioned outside, and I should have done. The general message is outside good, inside risky. And children, singing playgrounds, all of those initiatives. I think the case for children to sing for short periods outside, it needs to be made, and it is quite strong.
Mm.
A couple of questions that have come through, I guess, picking up on that kind of risk mitigation side of things. Obviously, outside, as you say, absolutely is something that should be encouraged. And so for those schools that do have outside space, I certainly know one teacher I was speaking to last week said, well, you know, we've got big playing fields, so we're putting up a big marquee, we're going to open the side, surely, you know, that's fine. So there are, you know, for those who are lucky enough to have the space, that's great. But a couple of questions coming through from people around things like masks or kind of shields, perspex shields, you know, do we see a place for using those?
Shall I go first on that? I think Boris wore a mask at lunchtime on the news today, and that represents that the general movement, you know, people say yes, no, but the general movement is towards masks. And again, if you look around the world, the countries that have done well in this are the ones where it's culturally easier to wear masks. The problem is a lot of objections, and somebody mentioned Canada. There's some good work being done in Canada where children fiddle with their masks and they get irritated, and that makes it worse because they scratch their nose, which is the very thing you shouldn't do. So there are issues with children and masks, and face visors are not going to protect you against aerosols. I went for a curry on Saturday, and some of the guys were religiously, the waiters, wearing face visors. That is not going to stop aerosols being directed down from the visor and filling the room up. So if there is going to be a mask, it's got to be a 3-laminate layer cloth mask that fits well. And, you know, Claire is professional, working with children every day. There won't be anything I can tell her about little children fiddling with masks.
If I was a parent listening to this now, I'm a parent with older kids, but if I was a parent listening to them, I'd be horrified. I'd be worried about taking my child to school at any time. And I know, Claire, you probably experienced trying to encourage parents to come to school and messages that we've got to do for September to encourage children to attend. We live in a very risk-averse society, yeah, without a shadow of a doubt, yeah, and this is pre-COVID. That's had, I think, serious implications for children to be able to manage conflict, relationships, yeah, and grow up to get the skills that they need when they go into adulthood, workplaces, and they have into relationships that are challenging, yeah. That children don't have an opportunity to manage risk and experiment risk, and indeed sometimes occasionally get harmed, hopefully in a very minor way, when they encounter risk. I think we've got to be very careful about that. It's certainly important that we keep people safe, but there's a balance that we have to give quite clearly, and it is very confusing with all the advice that's going around at the moment and the lack of specific evidence. But I think we've got to be very careful about the message that we give, that we don't give inadvertently parents a belief that somehow schools are one of the most unhealthy places, and there's absolutely no way I'm going to even contemplate sending my child to school, whether it's mandated or otherwise. It worries me that we've got to be able, that we haven't quite got the messaging, the balance right between what is a reasonable risk, yeah, as opposed to being completely risk averse. And as you were saying, Martin, that you know, children transmitting viruses and, you know, picking them up are extremely limited, but we can't eliminate the risk. But there is a careful, I think, the language that we use with parents, and indeed with children, because children can get extremely anxious as well about their own mortality. If we keep saying to them, you're about to enter a place that is deadly and dangerous.
It's a really important point, and I think you know, it's one of the things that we're certainly concerned about at the Voices Foundation, is that in that kind of, you know, sort of almost knee-jerk reaction sometimes to sort of go, you know, to protect children and to, you know, to sort of minimise risk, that in the process of doing that we pull away so many opportunities that, to your point, John, are essential. So whether that's kind of, you know, managing risk and being able to face challenges and kind of deal with that, obviously in the specific context of today, thinking about singing, if we all kind of go, oh gosh, singing sounds dangerous, let's just scrap that from the curriculum, there we go, job done, we've mitigated that risk. Well, yes, you might have mitigated the risk, but how much will the child be losing on the other side? That's why it's so important that we wanted to have this conversation today, and we'll continue to have this conversation over the next few months. Claire, I don't know if you just wanted to kind of jump in there and say, obviously you've had some of the year groups return already, so that I imagine you'll have been dealing with some of that anxiety and hopefully found ways to overcome some of that.
Yeah, definitely. I think it's that initial bit for most of our families. Once they were back in, and once they started to come in, and we've definitely seen an increase in numbers. I think as words got around, people are getting more confident. You know, we have seen an increase in numbers, which stands us in good stead. A lot of the risk assessments that we've done and the procedures that we've had to put in place stand us in really good stead kind of for September. We know much more now about the practicalities and how it's going to work. And I think in terms of singing is normal for us. Singing and music should be normal for all children. We've got to work out somehow in September how we get that normality back. It's not normal, but you know, once children come through my doors, I want it to be as normal as I can make it. The children have adapted very quickly to hand washing, to not mixing at the minute with certain groups, to having different adults. You know, the majority of children have handled that amazingly. So once we get kind of through, it's just, we've just got to be a bit more creative at the minute. Until things, you know, we need to do something to get what our normal is at Eastfield and hopefully would be at other schools. We're working really hard as a trust and at school level to get that back. And that includes music and singing, which, you know, is more important now than ever, really.
Yeah, and to just connect Claire and John together, I would say you do not control risk by eliminating it altogether. Mm-hmm. And interesting to hear Claire say how quickly the children have taken up the hand washing. You know, it's probably a way to educate parents, because children do take this on board. And, you know, I keep going back to this curry I had on Saturday. It was really quite distressing. There was a woman in the sort of ante room where they pour you wine, who was shrieking and cackling at the top of her voice. Now, there's a basic public education issue there, that is doing more harm than not social distancing. Now, children will pick that up if they're told. They will know, and they'll educate their parents. So, yeah.
Thank you so much. I'm conscious we're at time, so I'll wrap it there. Thank you for everyone who asked their questions. I'm sorry if we didn't quite get to yours, but we will be continuing the conversation over on Twitter, so hashtag VFSingWell. So if you didn't get your question answered there, please do tweet to us and we'll try and get back to you on that. A huge thank you to the panellists. I think it's been incredibly valuable, even if I did drop out a couple of times with my internet. It's been an incredibly valuable discussion, and I think not that I was ever in any doubt, but I think we have definitely made a very strong case for why singing is essential, not just for children, but for all of us, but in this context, particularly for children, both because of its intrinsic value, but also because it does have a proven direct impact on well-being, which is important now more than ever as they're tackling this kind of very confusing world with all of these risks being pointed out to them all the time. We at Voices believe passionately in the power of singing and making that accessible for every child. But also recognise that the huge challenges that we're all facing at the moment, the kind of uncertainty, the lack of the kind of scientific information and some of the kind of wild extrapolations that have been made from the small pieces of evidence that we do have, that have kind of set some hairs running, conflicting government guidance between different government departments, and the fact that guidance is evolving all the time. And then amongst all of that, head teachers like Claire, who are trying to sort of navigate their way through and find a way to make sure that singing remains on the agenda, and the children have access to that in the new year. So it's a difficult kind of course to chart, but I think a really important one. I think, as we've just been saying, it would be a real shame if we just kind of threw our hands up and said, "Oh, well, this all seems a bit difficult. Let's forget singing then." It's too important to do that. So thank you, everybody who's joined the conversation today. If you're a school who's thinking about how you can get singing on the agenda in the autumn, then the Voices Foundation is here for you. We want to kind of give you the support that we can to as we have been doing with Claire at Eastfield, to make sure that singing can be on the curriculum. So do reach out to us at voices.org.uk to find out more about our programmes. And as I said, do keep the conversation going on online, and I'm sure we'll be doing another one of these sessions, because the evidence and the guidance will undoubtedly have changed again in another month or two. So watch this space for more events from us as well. So thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.